Hello everyone, I am Vinay Sheth from Travo Teachers and currently I am pursuing B.E. Computer Engineering from Vishwakarma Government Engineering College, Ahmedabad, Gujarat Technological University. So the basic objective of our educational startup Travo Teachers is that students, teachers and institutions must be provided with some common platform so that they can succeed professionally. So as a part of the event, Travo Talk 3.0, which is based on the topic student, teachers and analysis, we have Prasant Samantharaj sir, who will be talking on the topic importance of test. So if we talk about Prasant Samantharaj sir, he is currently the assistant professor at BITS Pilani Hyderabad campus, and he has research interests in ADS, CFT correspondence, then phase transitions in material models and quantum fields and many more. And he has a lot of publications and honors in his name. So, sir, it will be a very interesting talk with you. And before I request you to start, I would just request the audience to follow the COVID-19 protocols as suggested by the government authority. Wear masks, make appropriate use of sanitizers and get yourself vaccinated. And protect yourself, your family and everyone. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Vinay, and I would like to thank Travo Teachers for this excellent initiative. I mean, this is absolutely fantastic. You know, to get together teachers, students, and of course the audience, which is, I believe, it's slightly more general, to come at a single platform, you know, so that interchange of ideas can happen. This is absolutely fantastic. So I would like to thank Travo Teachers for this initiative. And also, it's a pleasure to be part of this initiative. Okay, so that's my opening statement. Yeah.
So, sir, we are with the motto that students will get to know more about the general topics such as the importance of tests and its analysis, and also about digitalization in the field of education. So, how do you think that these things are important as per the changing pattern of the education in our country?
Okay, so I'll take it. I mean, I'll just be quite brief with it because I'm sure that we will go into a bit more detail as this discussion progresses. So right. I'll be brief with points. The first thing is about tests. All right. So we all know that tests are, you know, we can't do away with tests. Okay. And why we need tests, that's a different discussion altogether. Okay. Maybe I will touch upon that much later, but tests we can't do away with. Analysis, absolutely important. Without analysis, tests make no sense. Okay. Then about digitization. Okay. So I think, for example, especially in today's system, okay, where every year around like hundreds of students, like if I take example of BITS or say even IITs or any big engineering colleges, they take students like, you know, per year the intake is close to 1,000.
Yeah.
Okay. And when you have such a huge intake, it is very, very important that you use technology.
Right.
All right.
Right.
All right. But when I say you use technology, that's actually a pretty vague statement. When I say you use technology in the sense you use tools or technology which will assist you in improving the education all over. Okay. Right. In the sense that I'm not saying you should always use PowerPoint presentation to teach. So that in many cases puts the students to sleep. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not saying you should not use it either. For example, you want to showcase some demonstration or some kind of a simulation. Okay. Obviously, you cannot do that with a blackboard. So for right. that, you need technology.
Right.
All right. And now you all must be aware that education is gone online. All right. Mm. It's absolutely online. And from tests to analysis to what you call data collection, everything is happening online using technology, right. using platforms, various platforms. Okay, you have Google Forms, you have Canvas platform, like you have something called Metal, which we use. They all have their advantages and disadvantages, but that's okay. I mean, we don't have an option, all right? So with the changing scenario where, you know, now what happens is students don't have to wait for the professor to come, you know, to the class and teach something. He or she can actually go to MIT courseware and I can get the same education. All right. So that's basically what it has come to. And I believe that we have to evolve with it. So yes, I would say that we need to adapt to this situation and digitalization is very, very important. But it has to be used judiciously.
Yes.
Again, with everything, it depends. Okay. It depends on the context, situation, time. It's necessary, but it is not, it should not be
overused. Not compulsory. Right.
Absolutely. It should not be overused or abused is the right word.
So, sir, please share something about your journey. I mean, how you got interested in this field, particularly.
Okay. All right. So, the thing is, I guess I wanted to do physics. I mean, I decided that I wanted to do physics, especially physics that is more mathematically oriented. Okay. I'm not that good at experimentation. I mean, hands-on experiences and all that. I was never good at it. Okay. But I was always interested in, say, mathematical equations and topics in physics where, calculus is used. So I always had that interest that I want to do that. And this is because I remember when I was in my 10th class, okay, in my 10th class, I started learning calculus pretty early. Okay, so I actually learned integral calculus pretty early. Like at 10th class, I knew what is integral calculus. I could do integration. Of course, I did not know what exactly is calculus. That's a deeper subject. Okay, that's actually your proofs and all that, like highly abstract. That's the foundation of mathematics that comes from set theory and all that. I didn't know that, but I was good at calculations. Okay, I knew integration, differentiation, I could do pretty quickly. All right. And then what happened is that I used to interact with one of my teachers. Now that teacher actually taught me one evening, I remember, he told me how does planet moves around the sun.
Okay.
And it goes in an elliptical orbit. Mm. And I knew that it goes in an elliptical orbit, but then he said that you have to prove it, that it goes in an elliptical orbit. How do you do that? So he actually taught me using calculus, which included, of course, a lot of integration and all that, that actually the planet actually goes around ellipse. Now that was actually a eureka moment for me. See, I am a 10th class student. Okay. I had just completed my 10th. And just with the power of pen and paper, no telescopes, nothing, I can say that Earth goes around sun in an elliptical orbit. Now that's like, that gave me a sense of like, it was quite overwhelming. I mean, to be honest, I felt like, wow, I mean, this is real power. Okay. So, So that was like a tipping point. I mean, I would rather say that was a tipping point. And on that day, I decided that this is something cool. I mean, I want to do this. I want to pursue this. Okay. So ever since that, I always wanted to do that. But then as fate might have for me, I ended up graduating as a mechanical engineer. Okay. So again, there's an anecdote to that as well. So what happened is that, I got through IIT joint entrance. Okay. And so I went for counseling at IIT Madras. And at that time, engineering physics was launched. Okay. BTech in engineering physics was launched. And if I remember correctly, it was launched only in Delhi. Okay. Delhi, maybe Mumbai, I don't recollect, but Delhi, for sure Delhi. And I went and asked the professor that I want to do engineering physics. Okay. My father was also there. And the professor immediately said, no, don't do that. Because it has just been launched. We don't know what the future of that course is. So I would suggest that with your rank, you either go for Kharagpur Electrical or Mechanical Engineering at IIT Madras. Okay. So effectively, you see how the social structures and conditioning works. So a professor at IIT tells me, that don't do physics. It's not safe. Okay. You go ahead and do this. I don't blame him because, he was just saying that to be safe. All right. It's fine. Yeah. I mean, it's his opinion. It's fine. And I ended up doing mechanical engineering. Now, I didn't enjoy it much. Okay. I mean, truthfully, I didn't enjoy it much. Not that I was very bad at it, but I didn't enjoy it much. In fact, most of the classes which I could not follow, I used to go to classes. Okay. I mean, one of the reasons why you have to go to classes, attendance is mandatory. I mean, absolutely mandatory. If you don't go, you can't write exams. Okay. So you go. And you go, but what happens is that I used to phase out. I mean, I completely phased out what is going on. Somebody is talking about nuts and bolts and all. I just can't relate to it. So what I used to do is to go to the last bench and I used to write down mathematical equations. Okay. So this happened and all that stuff. And eventually got in contact with some professors there in physics. I said that I'm very interested in physics. I want to do physics and all that stuff. So they also, but you know, I'm a mechanical engineer. I don't have a physics background. Okay.
Yeah.
So they were quite skeptical about it that maybe, you know, I may not be able to pursue it. I don't have it in me, you know, to do it in physics, whatever. But eventually I ended up in physics and I did a PhD in physics. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So
I mean, it is ultimately entirely, it is the destiny, which is.
Yeah. See, first of all, you have to work towards it.
Yeah.
That does not guarantee that you will succeed in what you want to do, but that just ticks one checkbox that you are doing your best. If destiny fails, then you will succeed.
Then you will, yeah.
It is possible that, you know, you may try your best, but you may not succeed because of luck, fate, whatever you may call it. Okay. So that's all. So nothing is guaranteed in life, but at least you don't have any option of not trying. See, you can't say that, oh, simply because there is no guarantee, let me not try. Okay, so it clicked for me. I'm not saying that it will click for everybody or it will not click for people from here on. No, nothing like that. What I'm saying is that if you have some passion, some interest, you go for it and see what happens. Okay, that risk taking ability, I think people should have. Yeah, so that's about it. Yeah.
So nextly, astronomy and astrophysics is all about experimentation, implementation, and then waiting for the results. How do you think that this also associates with the learning of students?
Okay. So, by the way, whatever I'm going to say in this discussion, it's purely my personal views. Okay. Mm-hmm. In the sense that this is coming from my own experience. Okay, it's not necessary that what I'm saying or suggesting is the right way necessarily for everybody. I just want to make that disclaimer right away. Okay. Now the thing is, see, when I did my PhD, of course, it was not in astrophysics per se or astronomy. I was always interested in these subjects, but technically my field was something called high energy physics. Okay.
Okay.
High energy physics and mostly theoretical high energy physics. So I am more, interested in questions like, what is the fundamental nature of space and time? Okay, what happens at the singularity of something like black holes? Okay, of course, I know that many of you might not understand what a black hole is, but just assume that there is some exotic object, okay, in the universe and we don't understand it fully. And somehow tied with its understanding is, is also related to the fundamental question that what happened during Big Bang, what was there before Big Bang, and all those questions. So I actually studied those things. All right. Now, coming to your question, during my PhD, there used to be like months, okay, months used to pass without any result coming out. Okay. It used to be quite frustrating at times. But I did not have any option. I just had to continue carrying on. Okay. You just have to carry on. Now, how does it map to learning of a student? Okay. Forget about education system in India, West and all that. If you just ask me learning, how does it map to that? The students also need to just carry on. If they don't understand something at some point of time, it is okay. People need not get frustrated. Okay. They just have to continue working on it. I guarantee you that 9 out of 10 times, things will become clearer as you become more and more, what you call, you'll become comfortable with it as you more and more encounter it.
Yeah.
So it is more about getting used to rather than understanding it. It's a very complicated network here, in my opinion. For example, in abstract mathematics, okay, I'll just give you an example. In abstract mathematics, what happens is that when you take a book and read about something in abstract mathematics, you will not understand anything. But the thing is, you read it every day. read it every day. I mean, just algorithmically read it every day. I guarantee you that in 10 days, you will actually try to understand what is happening. Don't ask me how it works. It's at the neuroscience level. Okay. But it is more about getting used to, or like, you know, getting used to the language.
Yes.
Okay. So it's like that. Similarly, in many things, in physics, in math, in any subject, okay, a 10th class, 11th class, 12th class, even undergrads, or even PhDs, you just have to continue working. Continue working. Even if you don't understand, just read again and again and again and again until you are completely sure that I will never understand this. Then you basically move on. Okay. But I guarantee you that 9 out of 10 times you will make peace with it and you will understand it. Okay. So as far as astrophysics, astronomy, or whatever high energy theoretical physics research goes, is the same thing as learning. I mean, learning is common. We are all students. I'm also a student. So right now I'm talking to you as a student as well as a teacher.
Yes.
Okay. So a teacher is always a student. I think this is something that the teachers should never forget. Okay. So when some student says that I'm finding it difficult to understand some concept, it's very important for us, like teachers like us, to go back in time. Okay. Transport back in time. And just imagine when I was in his or her age, how was I struggling with it? And how did I come out with it? Okay. So that's what you can impart to the students, that, hey, I struggled with it at that time. And this is what helped me. Maybe you should try this. Maybe it will help you. Maybe not. That's a different thing. But why not? Give it a shot.
Yeah.
Okay. But the point is, learning is a long process. It's a long process. It does not happen. It just does not happen immediately. Okay. I'll touch upon this immediate learning and, you know, taking time and all that a bit later, maybe in future. I'm sure that something will touch on that. But all I'm saying is that it takes patience. And
yeah,
you can't cheat out. You can't cheat your way out of learning. Yeah. Yes. So that's about learning and the parallel with astrophysics and astronomy research.
Yeah. So nextly, as you all are facing issues during this pandemic, then how do you think that tests are important for maintaining the consistency of the student during this time?
Okay, so here I have few things to say. Like, you remember I said in the beginning of this discussion that tests are, you can't do away with tests.
Yeah.
Okay. So that statement still holds. Pandemic or no pandemic, you cannot do away with tests, especially when you're talking about tests which will definitely, what you call, decide your professional career to a good degree. Okay. You can't do away with it. For example, recently you must have heard that the government canceled 12th board.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't think government can cancel, say, entrance exams. I don't think they can do that. Okay. Because that would not be practically feasible. Okay. So tests will be there in some form or the other. Now, given that, and given the pandemic, what I believe personally is that I think the test needs to be modified, and the form of the test needs to be modified, in the sense that, see, this is a difficult situation. Many people have lost their near and dear ones in this COVID situation. People have been very mentally occupied because of this whole, you know, pandemic. And it's very depressing to be under a lockdown. And moreover, to continuously watch lectures on the laptop or phone, worse, laptop is still better because, you know, your vision is actually slightly spread out. But many people actually, what they do is they watch the lectures on phone. Now, that's absolutely terrible. I mean, it's absolutely terrible. The reason is because you have zero focus on that. You will not register much. Okay. And then when you do this for the entire day, you don't learn much. When you don't learn much, to give a test which is, you know, which is absolutely, what do you call, soul crushing, I must say, that is devastating. Absolutely devastating. So what can you do? So, well, one thing that you can do is that, and this is again my completely personal opinion, is that one can reduce the bit of a syllabus. Okay, one can reduce the bit of a syllabus. Instead of having the entire syllabus, maybe you can say that, okay, the tests will be focused on these areas mostly. Okay, now, once you do that, then maybe what you can do is you can formulate the test in such a way. I think there is something called the Bloom's taxonomy or something like that, based on which you formulate the test. Now, I don't completely agree with it, the way it is formulated, but what I do believe is that many of the topics can be done away with. Okay, for example, you're teaching, say, physics 101, which includes fluid mechanics, mechanics, normal mechanics, waves, okay, harmonic oscillator and all that stuff. You don't need everything. Okay, you don't need everything. You can condense the whole thing and maybe focus on a part of it. Okay, now coming to what you call the level of the test or how the test has to be formulated is that I don't believe in lengthy tests. Okay, and I also do not believe in trick questions. In examinations, I do not believe in trick questions. Okay, I believe that the test should actually test the understanding of the coursework. In the sense, for example, if I have taught certain concept in the class that this is how you should compute things and have given an algorithm that you should do that, then the test should test that algorithm. Okay. The test is not like a joint entrance exam where, you know, no, I mean, that's not the case. Okay. That's a different thing. The test should not test your ability to be creative. Okay. I mean, some part of creativity is okay, but it should not be too heavily bent on the fact that I will give a completely new problem. And, you know, when I say completely new problem, in the sense you have to really, really think completely out of the box to solve it. Okay. No, we don't need to do that. Okay. Have it straightforward. But even when I say you have it straightforward, it is not going to be an easy test. Okay. It has to cater to the entire spectrum of students, right from students who could not cope up with the course for no fault of theirs. See, somebody who's not able to cope up with the course is not his or her fault. I'm not saying it's the teacher's fault either. Okay. What I'm saying is that maybe the student does not relate to the course. It's as simple as that. For example, I did not relate to nuts and bolts and electrical machines during my mechanical engineering. It's not teacher's fault that I did not relate to. It just didn't work out. Okay, look at it as a relationship. You can't have relationships with everybody, right? It needs to work out. The frequency has to match. Okay, you may try working at it, but it's not guaranteed that it will always work out. Okay, so students need to understand this, that not everybody can do mathematics at a certain way, in a certain way. Not everybody can understand chemistry in a certain way. For example, I am terrible at chemistry. That does not mean my IQ is very low or that I am incapable or incompetent. Okay. But I just can't do chemistry. I don't hate the subject either. The worst thing is that I love the subject, but I can't do it. It's simple. Fact, accept, move on. Okay. If I force myself to build a career in chemistry, I will set myself up for misery. So don't do that. Students should understand this and not blame themselves. Okay. Now there are points and there are things where students need to take responsibility for themselves, but this is not what they should do. Okay. Now, coming back to again the test during pandemic and all that, as I said, course needs to be condensed. It can be condensed. That is definitely possible. Okay. I personally believe it is definitely possible. And moreover, the examination should not be trick-based. It should not basically trick you into thinking out of the box. That's because, see, tricks are like, if instead of 2 hours, I give you 5 hours, maybe you will crack the trick. Okay. But in 2 hours, you could not crack the trick. What does that tell you? It doesn't tell you anything. That it has nothing to do with your competence. Okay. You were lucky enough, you could crack it. You were not lucky enough, you could not crack it. So that's nothing. I don't pay too much attention to it. So the examination should be basically, when people say concept based, what do you mean by concept based? Concept based meaning that it should test whatever algorithm was given, the methodology that was taught to you, you should be comfortable in that. Now, I will actually speak about this a bit more, but not now, because I think this is slightly going tangential. But I'll talk about students' responsibility in preparing for the tests. Okay, that comes in analysis perspective, and I think we will talk about it maybe later. Okay, but as far as tests go, mandatory, you can't do away with it. Just one small thing, okay, and this is something all the students need to know. Absolutely, they need to know. This is again a brutal truth. Okay, I think a month ago, one of my students, I had taught him much earlier. So he approached me and said that, sir, the institute has given me an option due to this COVID pandemic that I may opt for something called clear grade. That means just a pass grade. I don't have to write the exam, but I will just get a clear grade depending upon how much marks I have already acquired before my final exam. Yeah, not previous semester, but till then. I mean, it's a continuous evaluation system. So you don't have to write the final exam or the comprehensive exam. Okay, end semester exam, you don't have to write. You just, if you have enough marks, I think that is very, minimal threshold, like 20% marks or something like that, if I remember correctly, you can opt for a clear grade. Okay, so he asked me, sir, should I opt for clear grades? Okay, so then I asked him, that's your decision, but what do you want to do after this? Then he said, I wanted to pursue a PhD in physics. Okay, then I told him something which is absolutely brutal truth. And this has nothing to do with COVID pandemic or anything like that. I gave him a picture, which is as follows. I told him that if you opt for clear grades in your physics courses, okay, so he's a physics major. Okay, I mean, his master's is in physics. I told him, if you opt for clear grades in your physics courses, you will be at a serious disadvantage when you apply for a PhD program. Why is that? Because of the fact that suppose you apply to, just example, MIT. Okay, you apply to MIT. Now, MIT get 300 applications. Okay, and all 300, I can tell you, along with the letters of recommendation and all that, they are all exceptional students. Everybody is extremely good, high CGPA, fine. I mean, on paper, you can't say that he is better, he's not good, or all that stuff. Now, in those 300 applications, they are coming from all over the world. And if I understand correctly, United States and Europe, their universities are almost functioning normally, even in this pandemic. Okay, now that is because they have low population, their vaccination policy, whatever. But somehow I know that US is functioning almost normally as far as universities go. Okay, they are not giving clear grades to anybody. No clear grades nowhere. Everybody is writing an exam for good or bad. I don't know whether they are suffering or not. I don't know that also, but they're writing exams. Bottom line, when I have two applications, on one application, everything is clear, 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 clear. And the other side, you have marks 99, 99, 99, 99, 99. You don't stand a chance. Yeah. I'm not saying this is a good thing. I'm not saying this is a bad thing. I'm just saying this is how it is. Now, with this knowledge, you take a decision whether you want to go for that clear grade or you want to write an exam and do it. See, the reason is the following. I'll tell you why this sounds insensitive, but it's the brutal truth. The professor at MIT does not have the time to call you personally and ask you, why did you not write the exam? Did somebody die in your family? No, he's not going to do that.
Yes.
Okay. So tests during pandemic, that is the reason why it's still happening. If we can guarantee, you know, it's a other society, it's a different parallel, in a parallel universe, if we could guarantee everybody that don't have to write tests, all of you will get job, all of you will be able to do whatever you want to, then tests are not required. Absolutely not required. So I'm very objective about it. I don't place importance on tests or not tests, but I just want to tell you how the world operates. You can rant about it, saying that this is not how it should be. But simply because you don't want the world to operate in a certain way, the world is not going to change its ways. Okay. So, yeah. So, tests are necessary in this context. Okay. Yeah. All right. So, let's move on. Yeah.
What are your views on personalized test analysis? Also, how are they fruitful to students? And what all aspects a teacher should talk during personalized analysis of a student after a test?
Okay. All right. So, see, if you have a very small classroom, all right, and you have like 10 students or something like that, then this personalized assessment makes sense in the sense that I can call each one of them, look at their mark sheet, look at their answer sheets, and I can tell them that this is where you went wrong, this is where you need to focus, this is where, you know, concepts are lacking or something like that. That would work, provided you have like a very small classroom. Now, what happens in today's times is that it's not possible to do that because you have large classrooms. Like right now, I have a classroom which is close to 500 students. Okay. Now, I can't do personalized analysis for each one of them. Is it a bad thing? Absolutely, it's a bad thing. But I just can't do it. Nobody can do it. Okay. So what's the way out of it? So the way out of it is that when I'm teaching, okay, when I'm teaching, I give my students, I try to at least, I don't know how successful I am, but at least I try to give them guidelines or tips so that they themselves can do personalized analysis of their tests. And then they can write to me or come to me and say that this is what has happened. Can you help me?
Yeah.
See, there is a difference. I will tell you two scenarios. Okay. The two scenarios are the following. There is a test. For some reason, there is a test. Okay. We have to play by the rules of the system. So there is a test. Okay. You went through the test. And then what happens is somebody did not fare very well. Let it be a boy. It could be a girl. Okay. But for simplicity, let's assume that. Okay. Let's assume it's a girl. Okay. So she comes to me and says, that sir, I did not fare very well. Can you help me? Okay. Help me how to get more score. That is situation one. Situation two. The same girl comes to me and says, sir, I've observed that every time there is a question on simple harmonic oscillator, I make a mistake. Can you help me? So what's the difference between the two situations? In the second situation, the student has analyzed herself.
Yeah.
Okay. And she found a pattern. See, always there is a pattern. Okay. The pattern is that you always have a problem with a certain concept. And whenever that concept appears in any exam, you have a problem with it. And you may make a mistake. The probability of making mistake is high. Okay. So if you can figure that pattern out for yourself, it becomes extremely easy to diagnose the problem and treat it.
Yeah.
It is much more easy. See, if I go to a doctor and said, I'm not feeling well, treat me.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean anything. Okay. But if I go to a doctor and tell him symptoms that, you know, I have stomach pain, my stomach pain is towards my right part of the stomach below the rib cage, that allows the doctor to focus exactly what it could be. Yeah. Okay. So this due diligence, I believe, is both the responsibility of the teacher as well as the student. The teacher should tell the student every time that carefully observe where you are having problems. For example, in physics, a concept like torque. Okay. So if a student is finding again and again, difficulty in understanding this torque concept, and every time there's a question on torque, he or she makes a mistake, that's a diagnosed problem. Yeah. Something is wrong in understanding torque, concept of torque. That makes it simpler for me to help. Okay. You don't come to me and say, I did not understand that. I did not understand this. This did not work out. That did not work out. No. What you need to do is when you are not giving tests, when you are not under time constraint, you try to solve problems on your own and try to understand what is the pattern of mistakes you are committing. And I guarantee you that there will be a pattern. This is the key to improvement. Either you're writing IIT joint entrance exam or BITSAT, or you are writing any exam, even undergrad level. This is it. You will have a pattern. During my time, most of the students had a problem with mechanics. Okay. My time as in like when I was a student or when I was an undergrad. So, you know, always people had a problem with relative velocities, relative acceleration and all that. It confused them. So that's a diagnosable problem. Okay. People should not come and say, I don't I can't solve problems in mechanics. No, that's too vague. That means you have not done your homework. Yeah. What you need to do is to find out that pattern, and only students can find that pattern. One student can find that pattern for himself or herself. A teacher cannot find that pattern. And when the pattern is found, so teacher should encourage the students to find that pattern or mistakes. When the pattern is found, the teacher can definitely help. This is as personalized as it can get. You can't get more personalized than that. See, I don't believe in this, what you call, what happens is that there is softwares do this, okay? Mechanics problem one, 77% people did this. Harmonic oscillator, 27% did this. That does not tell me anything. Honestly, it does not tell me anything. It just tells me that, okay, 77 people did this. That's it. Beyond that, it doesn't tell me anything. Okay? So, I consider that as highly suboptimal. That is not personalized analysis. Personalized analysis, as the word suggests, is personal. I need to understand where I'm going wrong. No software can tell me where I'm going wrong. Yeah. I know, okay, I have enough practice with me. I know where I'm going wrong. And I should write those things down. I do not understand torque equation. If I solve 10 problems in torque equation, 8 out of 10 times I'm making a mistake. So there is a pattern. Similarly, tabulate this whole thing. This is what hard work is. Okay? And then you come to the teacher. And then tell the teacher that this is what I'm having a problem with. Then the teacher can quickly solve it. Or at least, you know, there is a hope of solution. So in my definition, this is personalized analysis, not some statistics. That statistics is basically something which has no relevance or no strong correlation with what a person is going through. Okay. Yeah. So that's my answer to that.
Sir, astrophysics enables to think in all the directions and considering all the possibilities. So how do you think that tests are helpful to the student in the same way?
Okay, fantastic. Again, I'll give you an anecdote, okay? Yeah. And this anecdote is actually around 15 days old. Okay. It happened just 2 weeks back. So what happened is some of the students missed their exam, mid-semester exam, because of genuine reasons, okay? So they missed out. So we have something called a makeup exam, okay? So we had a makeup exam in which I had framed a question. Now that question, actually it's an open book exam. Now that question that I framed, that question they have actually solved it a million times, okay? They've solved it a million times. It's actually a very, very simple question that I gave. I mean, simple in the sense, they've solved it a million times. So they know exactly what is happening, okay? But what I did is that I asked them to solve the question in a very different way. I told them that typically you might have used these methods to solve this problem in your JE preparation or, you know, whatever other courses it is. I don't want you to do that. I want you to solve it using a different method. You will get credit only if you do that.
Yes.
And that is something I have taught in the class. So again, algorithm.
Yeah.
Okay. So it is not a trick question. It's an algorithmic question. But I told them, don't use the methods that you are used to. You use the method which is different. Okay. And you know this method because I taught you this method. So you do that. The thing is, none of them did it. Nobody could solve it. Okay. Even though they know exactly what the final answer is. It's there in the textbook. They can refer to the textbook. They know exactly what the final answer is, but that's not important. I wanted to test their ability to execute an algorithm. Okay, it was not unfair, but I just wanted to test that. They couldn't do it. Okay, now why couldn't they do it? It could be many reasons. Maybe if I had given them 4 hours, they could have done it. Okay, it's possible. So what happened there? Okay. And how does it relate to astrophysics, astronomy, and you are thinking along all directions? I will just make a connection here right now. See, the biggest tip I can give to students, okay, about test taking is that when you get a problem and you are not under exam conditions, okay, you are not under exam conditions, you are like trying to practice, you get a problem, you try to solve it using as many methods as possible. You yourself do it. Okay, you become your own professor. You assume that you are going to give yourself a test. Okay, and then you ask yourself, if I have to give this problem as a test problem, how many ways in which I can frame this? So you, in other words, you anticipate that what could be asked. And that anticipation grows stronger when you take a problem and solve it in as many ways as possible, different methods. Then you are so set, whether it be JE exam or anything like that, you are ready because you know you have all the tools at your disposal to do that. Problem happens because somebody in coaching center tells them you do it in this method, this is the trick. And if something else comes out, that's it. It's done. Okay? They can't do it. This is the problem. So you should anticipate, the ability to anticipate what could be asked. That is where the hard work comes in. It's not about doing 10 problems in the textbook. You do those 10 problems, each one of them in three different ways. And you are done. You're absolutely done. Then sometimes people ask me, sir, is the textbook sufficient? My answer to that is that it is much, much, much more than sufficient. In fact, there are 30 problems in the textbook. I am saying you solve 5 problems, but you solve those 5, each one of them in 3 different ways. And you are done. You don't have to look at other problems also. That increases your probability of success under test-taking environment. Okay, just don't go by what I tell you in the class, what method I teach you, because I will again give that problem as exam problem and ask you to solve it in a different method. If I could ask you to solve it in a different method, you could have as well done it yourself before even it came in the exam. That anticipation ability you should have. People who are successful in tests are usually people like these, which have these qualities. So this is the most important tip. Either you're appearing for JE or you're appearing for your undergrad, this is it. Anticipate what could be asked, how the question can be twisted, how the question can be reformulated. This is it. So just one thing.
Yeah.
So you said that astrophysics allows you to think in all directions. So even at your level, you can think in all directions, all possible directions, and think how many possible ways are there to reformulate a certain problem. Yes, and solve it.
Yeah. Sir, what is the basic ideology that you follow in your field, and how do you relate it with learning and experimenting?
You're asking about my research field.
Yeah.
Okay. There is no fancy answer to that. I mean, honestly, okay. It's the same thing every single day. You wake up, have breakfast, sit at your desk, plug through those equations, struggle with those equations, and try to make epsilon progress each single day. Yeah. Epsilon. I'm not saying you have to do awesomely well. That happens. Some days, you know, things click and you do fantastic progress. Okay. But that does not happen every day. In fact, most of the days it does not happen. Most of the days I'm struggling with solving something. I can't solve it. And I can't give it up either, because giving up is not an option. Okay. And why it's not an option? Because you give up and you go over to another problem, there you will get stuck. You will give up and go over to another problem, there also you will get stuck. I mean, this is not done, right? I mean, how many times will you hop through? Okay, so that will not work. You have to work every single day. There is no fancy, method to it. I believe everybody who loves their subject, who loves their job, okay, has to do that. And I believe I'm very lucky that my hobby as well as my job is one and the same.
Yeah.
Okay. So every single day I don't come to the office and curse myself. Okay. So that's of course a different topic of discussion, but yeah, anyways.
Sir, apart from the test, what other method should be opted to check the learning of a student?
Okay, so that's actually a very difficult question. Honestly, okay, that's a very, very difficult question. I'll give you the right answer. I mean, what I believe is the right answer. The right answer is, of course, personal interactions. Okay. Personal interactions, because I know personally students who don't get good score in their exams, but when I do interact with them, they actually showcase high level of maturity in terms of the subject or the concepts, but they're somehow not successful under exam conditions. Okay, this can happen. This is absolutely normal. It's not necessary that somebody who understands, say, math, physics or chemistry very well, he or she will be always successful under exam conditions. Okay. So personalized, what you call interaction, is a much more stronger gauge of the ability of the student, long-term ability of the student, not just in test taking, but beyond test taking also. Nothing beats that. Okay. I want to make one more statement, but I guess that will be slightly tangential, but it's related to this tests, because I believe that I think this program, Tryout Teachers, it's also geared towards students who are about to take entrance exam, like 11th, 12th grade students, right?
Yeah.
I have an appeal to the not just to the teachers, their teachers, but also to their parents, that I think they're overdoing it a lot. I mean, it's just too much. I mean, by the time those students qualify those entrance exam and go over to the university, they are so burnt out. They have, yeah. I mean, the spark is completely gone, as if like they've already given up. Their whole what you call idea of life or success in life was that entrance exam. And once it is done, they have no purpose in life. Yeah. I see many cases on a daily basis. It's pathetic and it's very sad. And this is something, see, I can tell you right away, if you have to clear any entrance exam world over, you don't need 10, 15 hours of hard work. You don't need that. I can challenge anybody to convince me otherwise, but I guarantee you don't need that. Absolutely. If you want to clear the most toughest exam in this world, you don't need that. What you need is consistent hard work at an optimal level. I guarantee you that in a day, if you spend 6 hours or 8 hours focusedly, it is sufficient. You have 16 hours left in your life per day to do normal stuff, which you should be doing. Don't become that student where, you know, you have burnt yourself out to such a degree that when you go to an institute after you have cleared your entrance exam, you have no purpose left, or, you know, you have nothing to do. The spark is gone. Come on, you're 17, 18 years of age. At that age, if you are asking about what my purpose in life is, that's ridiculous. That is the question people like me should get. Even I should not get. Maybe 10 years down the line, I should get that. You know, what is my purpose? What is the purpose of my existence? No, the purpose of your existence is to struggle, take up a challenge and struggle. That is it. That gives you meaning. Life is suffering and suffering is meaning. Without suffering, there is no meaning. And you choose that suffering. You pick your suffering and stick with it. Okay, students don't understand this, and parents absolutely don't understand this. So if parents are watching this, please, 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 don't put your kids from 7th standard, 8th standard in coaching institutes and ruin their childhood. I mean, see, I also cleared IIT. Okay. My friends also cleared IIT. We all went together. I know how we did. Okay. Not a single evening passed by where I did not play, even during, I mean, you know, very close to joint entrance exam also. I did play. That is important. If I don't play, I would go crazy. At that age, if you don't do all these things, then I mean, ridiculous. I mean, I can go on and on over this, but if you want to qualify tests, there is an optimal way of doing it. You don't need to overreach. That is not going to help you. The best analogy I can give you is, again, I am a fitness enthusiast, so I will tell you. You exercise, your body adapts. How many hours should you need to exercise so that your body adapts optimally? 1 hour, 2 hours, 4 hours, 10 hours? If more is always better, then I can exercise 10 hours a day, no? Then I can be anything. It doesn't work like that. And how much one should work, that is personalized, that is subjective. I may need to work hard for 6 hours. Some other student might be slightly more gifted or lucky than me. He or she may be equally good at 4 hours of hard work. Some people may be slow in catching up. That is okay. Not everybody is equal. He or she may require 10 hours. But I guarantee you, nobody requires 15 hours. If you are requiring 15 hours to get something done, then even if you get it done and you go to the institute of your choice, you are screwed. The toughest thing is not to qualify entrance exams. The toughest thing is to sustain after you qualify exam. You sustain in that institute, sustain your passion, sustain your spark. If you have failed there, then something you did very, very wrong before entering the institute. That is it. So parents and teachers, all your FITG and all what I hear, quota and all, please, please, please. You don't need that much. You don't need to solve thousands of problems to qualify exams. I don't know when will this truth dawn on them. Maybe never. But yeah, that's it.
So nextly, sir, we want to ask you regarding some astrophysics concepts like what is a black hole and whether time travel is possible or not.
Okay. All right. So, okay, what's a black hole? Technically the answer is very complicated. Okay, it requires advanced mathematics to actually define what a black hole is. All right, so we'll not go into that, obviously. But for what you call laymen, okay, for people who want to get kicked about it, it's basically something like a massive star which has a mass greater than a certain threshold. It's called the Chandrasekhar's limit. Okay, so if you have a mass which is greater than that threshold, then what happens is that after the nuclear fuel which powers this star goes out, okay, it has basically exhausted its fuel. But then what happens is once it's exhausted its fuel, then the radiation pressure is gone. Okay, then there is nothing there is left to stop the star from collapsing under its own weight or under its own gravity, because gravity always attracts.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, the gravity always attracts. So what stops the star from collapsing is the nuclear processes that goes inside the star that makes the star burn. You know, there is a radiation pressure. There is an outward radiation pressure which balances this inward gravitational pull. So that's why the star remains in a stable situation like our sun. But now the question is, what happens when the star runs out of its nuclear fuel? Well, the answer to that is that if it is massive, that is massive beyond a certain threshold, after it burns out of its nuclear fuel, it starts collapsing. It continues to collapse. Okay. Now it's a very simplistic scenario I'm painting, but you can take it like as it is, that it continues to collapse and it collapses to something called a black hole. Okay. So what it does is that it modifies the region of universe, wherever it is, it modifies the immediate neighborhood of the universe around itself, in such a way that nothing escapes. Okay, I'm talking purely from a classical theory point of view. Classical theory means a canonical theory point of view, that nothing escapes, not even light escapes. Okay, so this is the standard, what you call, explanation of what a black hole is. It's an exotic object. It's something which has strong gravitational pull at its core. Okay, and we don't know what the ultimate fate of this collapsing black hole is. We don't know that. Okay, That's an unsolved question. That is something we also try to figure out in, you know, my research. But what happens is that this is all due to Einstein. Okay, this is all due to Einstein's theory of general relativity. Okay, that's basically theory of gravity. So it's basically an improvement over Newton's theory. In fact, it's not an improvement. It's basically very different. Okay, extremely different. And Newton's theory of gravitation and Einstein's theory of gravitation are poles apart. Okay, but why is it so successful? Is that I think in 2017, if my memory serves right, people got Nobel Prize for discovery of gravitational waves. Okay, so what happened is that two black holes collided, and when two black holes collide, there is ripple through the space and time itself. Okay, so assume that. Okay, what is an electromagnetic wave? Electromagnetic wave is a ripple, or basically fluctuations in the value of the electric and magnetic fields at a certain point of space and time. Okay, that's what an electromagnetic wave is. Basically, if you measure the intensity of the electric or magnetic field, you will see that it fluctuates. Okay, so that's basically an electromagnetic wave. What is a gravitational wave? A gravitational wave is basically a fluctuation in space-time itself. In other words, what was 1 meter is no more 1 meter. It fluctuates. It becomes 9.9999 meters for a minute, and then expands to 1.1111 meter, and then it goes back to 1 meter. Okay, so it stretches the space and time. The fabric of space time is stretched. And this discovery proved for the first time that black holes do exist. Okay, and of course people received Nobel Prize for it, but so that's the exotic power of black holes. And I believe, that's not the right statement. All astrophysicists believe that at the center of galaxies, spiral galaxies, ours is a spiral galaxy, Milky Way is a spiral galaxy, you have a supermassive black hole at the center, which powers this system. Okay. So at the center of every massive spiral galaxy, there is a supermassive black hole. Okay. And that supermassive black hole is the energy source for the entire galaxy. That's amazing. Okay. So yeah, so that's what a black hole is. Yeah. It's highly technical, of course. Yeah.
And regarding time travel, whether it is possible or not?
Oh, we have already achieved time travel. Yeah. We have already achieved time travel. When I say that, what do I mean by that? Is basically the fact that suppose you take a spacecraft, okay? Hypothetically, you go over to Jupiter, stay there for like few years and come back, okay? You would have aged less compared to people who were on Earth.
Yeah.
Okay? This is due to, again, Einstein's theory of relativity, and this has been measured, okay? Not that you went to Jupiter and came back, but anything that moves at ultra-relativistic speeds, that means speed closer to light or comparable to speed of light, okay? Like 100th the speed of light or something like that. They experience this dilation in time. That means for them, time flows slow. And many of you don't know this, but this time dilation effect is one of the crucial features of something called the global positioning system or the GPS. Now the GPS tracks, you know, aircrafts going from one point to other on Earth, right? So that this time dilation effect is built into the GPS system. Otherwise, the flights would not be synchronized. Okay, yeah. Not many people know this, but this time travel, what do you mean by time travel is that time flows differently for different people. If you say that this is what the definition of time travel is, then we have achieved time travel, at least in the forward direction. That means one can age slower compared to other.
Yeah.
That we have achieved it. It's observed also. But I think what you are asking is backward time travel for the same person. That means, can I go back in time to my childhood?
Yeah.
That's what stuff of science fiction is made of. Technical answer to that is that there are certain theories in Einstein's relativity where, you know, the concepts of wormholes and all exist. Mathematical solution exists, which connects two different space-time points. of the universe. Okay, I say space time points. That basically means time also is included. You can go from one time point to another time point, okay, using that wormhole. But it's highly speculative. I mean, you know, we don't know whether those solutions are stable to perturbations or not, or if you actually, you know, if you include effects of quantum mechanics, whether such a system is, you know, feasible or not. So in other words, there is some theoretical or mathematical abstract formulations in which such a thing is possible, but in real life practical terms, I don't think so. You can't go back and meet your grandmother. No, I don't think so. Yeah, but you can age slower compared to others. All you need to do is get a spacecraft and fly off and then come back. You would have seen that. Yeah, so that is possible.
One last question, sir, that one good thing which you would like to appreciate about our education system and one bad thing which needs to, or one thing which can be improved.
Okay. Okay, let me tell you the bad thing first. The bad thing is too many courses. And too many courses and too many courses. I mean, not necessary. I don't think for any branch of engineering or anything like that, you need so many courses. I really don't think so. I mean, it's an honest opinion. I mean, really, you don't need those many courses. If you ask me, I could have actually reduced it by at least 50%. Yeah, and you'll still do well in life. I strongly believe with reduced courses, you can learn much more, much better, and you can do quite well in life. I mean, there is nothing that will hold you back. Okay, so this is purely my personal opinion. Many will disagree with this, but it's okay. It's their opinion. I believe you don't need so many courses. Many courses. I fundamentally believe that everybody should know a bit of a certain level of mathematics. Okay, a certain level of data, ability to handle big data. Okay, these are absolutely mandatory courses. You don't need to know physics. You really don't, unless you want to do a PhD in physics, of course you don't, then you need it. But that's something you need to choose later. It should not be enforced on you. Okay, you definitely don't need chemistry, unless again, you want to do PhD in chemistry. Math, mandatory. Everybody should know math. Absolutely, you have no way around it. It's a language. It's a universal language of technology. So you have to know math. Okay. That is one thing. Data is another thing. You need to know how to handle data. Okay. That's one other thing. Then depending upon your branches, you can have some very basic core courses that will give you enough time to absorb what is being taught to you. Okay. And then you can do really well. And after, see, your IQ does not change or your intelligence does not change over time. It's constant. Okay. So if you want to learn a subject, you can always learn it later. It's not necessary that everything has to be done during this 4 years or 5 years or whatever. That's a fallacy. That's an illusion. Absolutely. Absolute illusion. I don't know when will our education policymakers understand this, because in the US or something, in their system, I don't think it is this much. They're not burdened this much. At undergrad level, they are not burdened this much. I know that for sure. Yeah. And about the good thing about our education system, well, I mean, okay. See, simply because I'm taking so much time, it does not mean that I'm not able to find a good thing. I'm just trying to find what is the best thing. Okay. Our education system is not bad. Okay. It's not bad. But what I told you is that improvement is required. But other than that, I think one of the best things about our education system is you do have a support system, which is probably lacking in the Western world. Okay, in the Western world, if you, during your learning, if you become depressed or if you become, there's a high possibility you will be alone. And you will be left alone, and not many people will be there to help you. Even professors have a very different kind of an equation with the students. Okay, I'm talking about most professors. There could be exceptions, but most professors are very, very formal with the students. It's a culture there. It's a cultural difference. Okay, here what happens is that we encourage students to come and talk to us. Okay, and now what happens is that sometimes there is a thin line. Okay, we want the students to come to us and we want to help you, but we as teachers have to be careful not to cross a line and encroach upon the students' personal lives.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is something that we have to take care of. So it's a double-edged sword. So you have the comfort of a support system, but that support system has to operate within its ambit, or within its domain. That domain should not be crossed. Okay, what happens, what I have observed in my case also, what has happened, I mean with me when I was a student, what has happened is that certain times the professor has commented on something like, why are you playing so much? Okay, no, that is something that we should not do. Okay, that is an overreach. So as long as we don't make that overreach, I believe that Indian education system is good because it has that support system for the students. American system does not have that support system. If you are, it's a highly, highly, I mean, the right word is it's effectively like a jungle. I mean, you are on your own. Okay. And there is nobody to look after you. If you fall behind, you fall behind. That's the reason why many of the students in America don't opt for college. College degrees, not many opt for. Majority of the population does not opt for college degree. It's a big deal because one thing, it's very, very costly. That basically means if you are paying that much amount of money, you better make it count. Okay. In Indian system, that does not happen. Even if some education is costly, the loan is taken usually by the father and paid by the father or mother. But in America, the loan is taken by the father or mother in the name of the student.
Yeah.
That means the student has to get a job and pay it back.
Yeah.
So the cultural difference, you can see that cultural difference. There's an advantage and disadvantage. But in Indian system, what happens is that it gives a lot of cushion to the student that don't worry. You do your stuff, we are with you. Okay. In the US, the logic is nobody will say worry, but people will say that if you fail, you fail. And you are done and you move on. That's it. Okay, so it's very objective in that sense, and I would rather say insensitive. Indian system is not that insensitive. So that's the best part. And you know what the worst part is, that we are overburdening our students. I mean, education system, we are overburdening with number of courses, number of hours of teaching, right from the time that you enter into your ninth grade, all you have to do is just read. The students that come here in their first years, I mean, unbelievable. I mean, first year, you are in first year. How old can you be? 18? Okay. And 50% of the people I see, they are unhealthy. I mean, at 18, you cannot be unhealthy. You should not be unhealthy. If you are unhealthy, you have done something absolutely wrong. Not you, your parents, your teachers of those times, they are all responsible for your state. I would rather blame them. Okay. And then they come here and then they're frustrated. They're saying that I'm not good for anything. I don't have any spark. I'm unhealthy. I don't want to exercise. I don't want to play. And hence, I don't want to study. And I don't have any friends because I don't look good. I mean, I come across so many cases every single day. People write to me. It's pathetic. I mean, I wish I could go back in time. Time travel was possible. I could go back in time and tell their parents that, why are you screwing your student? I mean, your kids. You want them to qualify exams? They can qualify exams, but you are just overdoing it. You don't need to do this. I wish I could do that, but yeah. So yeah, that's the worst part of the education system.
All right. So that was all, sir. I would like to conclude by thanking you. It was a very interesting session, and I hope the audience would also have enjoyed it. And we look forward for more future sessions and collaborations from your side. Thank you very much.
Okay. Great, Vinay. Thank you. Thanks a lot. And I would like to thank Trio Teachers for this fantastic event. All right. And I look forward to more events from your side. Okay. And I would look forward to hearing other experts or, you know, education people who come and speak about it. I would like to hear their views as well. Okay. So, yeah, great, great, great talking to you. And by the way, I cannot see any audience because I'm just talking to you. Okay. Yeah. I don't know whether. All right. But yeah. So thanks to the audience also who took their time off. I can't see any of them. Okay. But I still thank them if they took their time off from a Saturday and, you know, they heard me or whatever. Okay. Thanks a lot. And thanks for everything. Yeah. Great. Okay, thank you. Take care, Vinay. Okay, stay safe. All right. Okay.